The sound of a beep, whether that's at the checkout counter, linking the right product to the right information and the price, or in a hospital, giving the right medicine to the right patient, or maybe in a warehouse to make sure you're getting the right product to the right place. Today, we are going beyond the stripes to learn how, with a simple scan, a product could be identified and connected to a computerized system anywhere in the world using so-called GS1 standards. Here to talk more about GS1 is Bobby Claudio. He's the president of GS1 Philippines. Bobby, hi. Welcome to Market Edge. Good to meet you.
Good morning, Mimi. Thank you for having me on your show today.
All right. It's great to have you. Bobby, just very quickly, you're also a businessman. Before we get to GS1, maybe we could get a quick analysis of inflation figures for you. Is inflation a big issue in your industry?
Yes, Mimi, it continues to be, although the general macro figure is starting to go down, it's still an issue. The cost of doing business is still up, primarily because of the oil prices, the war in Europe, and else in the Middle East. And of course, our continuing the cost of doing business in the Philippines hasn't gone down. So inflation issues continue to try.
Yeah, well, that's not too good news, but let's hope the trend downward continues in the following months. In the meantime, let's go to GS1. GS1, I understand, stands for Global Standards 1. Bobby, could you give us the lowdown? What is GS1? Who owns GS1? And go ahead.
Yeah, GS1 is an international body. It's based in Belgium, Brussels, Belgium, and it's composed of about 169 countries. Each country has its own GS1 member organization, and I'm the president for the GS1 Philippines. So we take care, we are the only body in the world that has been recognized to establish a universal global product identification. So all over the world, all products carry a GS1 number, whether it's produced in the Philippines or in other parts of the world. They all carry a unique number. And that database is with the GS1 International or Global Office.
Bobby, just very quickly, so all barcodes, for example, existing barcodes here, I mean, you walk into a shopping mall, a product that you want to buy has a barcode. That barcode uses automatically GS1 already?
About 90%. I would say 90% of all barcodes that you see or are being scanned in department stores or supermarkets are GS1 number. For the purpose of educating the Philippine market, barcodes starting with 480 are products registered in the Philippines. If that doesn't necessarily mean it's produced in the Philippines, can be produced elsewhere, but they have been registered in the Philippines. So the 480 is the number for the Philippines. So also to further inform the public, the next four digits after the 480 is the company code. So it signifies the number of the company that owns that product that has that number. And then the subsequent number identifies the different products in its inventory.
So Bobby, how did you get, 90% of all the barcodes here following the GS1 standard? Are companies mandated by governments to follow this standard?
No, Mimi, this is a private sector effort, although we do cooperate and do work with the government agencies such as DTI and the BIR. Most companies, you see, it's a compelling reason for most companies, and we are encouraging the MSMEs. You see, if your product is not barcoded, it's difficult to enter the traditional retail, such as supermarkets and department stores, simply because it's going to be very difficult for the retailers to, every transaction at the checkout counter, we have to type what is the product, what is the description, whereas now we're just used to the beep, beep, diba? So products.
But why do they have to use GS1? They can make their own.
Because that is the internationally accepted standard right now. And I said 90% of the world standard are on GS1. GS1 was a result of the merger between the UPC numbering code in the United States and the European article numbering code in Europe. They decided to merge so that there won't be multiple product identification in different continents. They decided to create and merge together and form the GS1. So the GS1 has become the accepted international numbering system.
All right. I was looking at some statistics. You did say when it comes to scale and reach, there are local member organizations in 116 countries, over 2 million user companies spanning over 10 billion transactions per day. I wonder, for barcodes following GS1 standards, for example, there must be a repository where all the information is stored. Who has access to that repository, and is it safe?
Yes, we have that repository. It's called Verified by GS1. Mm-hmm. It's a new application that is being introduced internationally now. All products, almost all products all over the world, is listed in this database at the global office. Those that have access are first member countries. You have to be a member of a country, GS1 member organization. And as soon as you become a member, we assist in even activating. We call the GS1 Activate, especially for those micro and small industries that do not have barcodes yet. And then those who have barcode and are now members of each country, GS1, they have access to what we call the
Okay, I think our internet connection dropped right there. We're going to try to get Bobby. Okay, he's back here. Bobby, hi.
I got it. I think we're back.
Yes, we are. Go ahead. Bobby? And we lost Bobby again. We'll try to get him right back. So he was talking about the GS1 Global Standard 1 standard use of barcodes. He was saying that 90%, wow, 90% of products already in the Philippines already carry this. Bobby, you're back with us? Let's do
yes,
this one more time.
I can hear you.
Okay.
I can hear you. Okay.
All right.
So we're working on that now, you know, especially helping out our MSMEs. Mm. So those in the regions and in the provinces, especially our micro producers or producing bagoong or jams or whatever products, to start using barcodes, because that way it's easier for them to get inside supermarkets and department stores. And at the same time, it gives them access to export market, because the countries that import products would require a GS1 number.
I imagine, Bobby, it's not just in retail, even in services. This is a big help when you're doing inventory in your warehouse, or I imagine, you know, logistics companies, you beep on that barcode and you know exactly where the product is at the exact moment to make sure that the transport is very efficient. Do we have, Bobby, maybe numbers to back it up, the business use case of a global standard barcode when it comes to, number one, cost savings, number two, improved efficiencies?
Exactly what GS1 was created for, Mimi. The barcode is a productivity tool that was introduced, and we know how efficient it has been for retailers, particularly in their checkout counters. And we have happier consumers not spending hours on the queue line in the supermarkets just to purchase their products. Mm-hmm. It has really been a productivity tool, not just on the checkout portion, but also on the inventory management, the logistics supply chains, the deliveries. So all of this are now digital and are able to make the retailers and the manufacturers more efficient in their operations.
All right. Bobby, just very quickly, a look into the future. The barcodes are typically in stripes, you know, differing sizes and thickness of stripes. What do the next-gen barcodes look like? I imagine they're going to be dots, you know, QR codes, data matrices. Can you give us an idea how you think the barcode system will evolve over the next 10, 20, 30 years? Because right now, you know, the QR code is pretty big. Whether you're talking about Brazil's PIX QR, India's UPI QR, Indonesia's QRIS, or our very own QRPH. Even Singapore is doing an experiment with Singapore or SGQR Plus. And they're saying that these are successful examples of the basic idea that, you know, these barcodes actually work and they can be, you know, a universal language used by businesses all over the world.
Correct, Mimi. That's where the productivity really comes in. Because right now, the current 1D barcode, we call the one-dimension barcode, is nothing but black and white lines. And it just simply identifies the product by its number and its description. But the moving forward, in the next, say, 10 to 20 years, the QR barcode is what we call one-click unlimited possibilities. Because this time, the different sectors, like particularly the consumers, can now scan the QR codes on the product with their phones and can even find out what recipes they can cook out of that product, what allergies can be encountered in the products that are being sold. And then also for the manufacturers and the brands, they can now interact with the consumers because there will be a link to the manufacturer inside the QR code such that any inquiry from the consumers will be tagged by the manufacturers and can use this database to track the usage and the profiles of the consumers. Mm-hmm. So there is now interactivity. And then, of course, the speed of delivery, speed of inventory management, it will now be more efficient for the manufacturers and the distributors.
Wow, sounds like barcodes, QR codes. You guys are forming the backbone, part of the backbone of the Internet of Things.
Correct. That's why we say one click, unlimited possibilities.
All right. On that note, exciting times ahead. Thank you so much, Bobby, for joining us and for introducing us to the concept and to the behind the scenes of barcodes. Thank you again, and we'll see you soon.